Dan Harris, you're up next.
Actually, you know, Sally asked my question. I was interested in hearing you guys riff on Joel Osteen. If you have further thoughts on that, you didn't weigh in on it, but I'm particularly interested in him, and if there's anything new you had to say, I'd be interested to hear it. If not, I defer to others.
Do you have comments on Joel?
Not on Joel Osteen per se, but here I would rely on the work of a formal doctoral student and now my new colleague, a woman named Catherine Bowler, has written a wonderful dissertation, a book coming out that it's very helpful to me. And she studied Osteen in the Osteen community as well as Kenneth Hagin and many of the other prosperity evangelists. And
when's the book come out?
In the fall. Okay. And it's a book, and it's being published by Oxford, and it has just a one-word title, and it is blessed. What's that? Her argument is that the prosperity gospel is, on the whole, not about financial prosperity. What it's on the whole about is spiritual prosperity and even more healing. Families, the formation of communities of support and resource for one another. And it's a very compelling story, particularly as she looks at prosperity preachers on the ground. And even with, say, ones who I would have a lot of difficulty with, such as Benny Hinn and the men and women who affiliate with him. Again, with her interviews, it's a deeply ethnographic book. With her interviews, what keeps coming through is that money is more or less incidental to the family, to the healing. I don't mean family in the sense that, say, the LDS might think of it, but to the kind of creation of a family feeling of mutual support for one another. So that's my only comment about Osteen, and my feeling is that probably both evangelical and mainline theologians are too quick to dismiss the entire prosperity gospel because we get sidetracked on the explicit message without gaining a sense of the tensile strength of what happens within the constituency.
What's your colleague's name again?
Catherine Bowler, that's spelled with a C. Catherine, B-O-W-L-E-R.
And she's talking more about the message as it's received as
it's... Exactly, exactly. The message as it is received and lived and internalized
But probably also as it's given. I mean,
well,
if you read...
Well, no, listen to Creflo Dollar.
Well, Creflo...
He's really explicit, especially in his early days. I mean...
But this is why Osteen is such an interesting figure, because he's doing multiple different things, and he isn't just standing up and saying, you know, God wants you to be rich and here's my Rolls Royce that proves it. It's a much more, I mean, Sally, I think you probably have more to say about this because you've interviewed him, but I would say that, you know, in the book I've written, I'm obviously very, very critical of figures like Osteen, but I completely agree that there's a tendency to say, well, we should be critical because this is just absurd, because it's people making ridiculous claims and so on. But actually, it is a much more, I think, theologically subtle and theologically appealing message than both sort of secular liberals and more traditional Christians give it credit for. And it wouldn't be, you know, it wouldn't have the appeal it does if it didn't contain real subtleties as well.
Well, Dan used the word received, and I would use a similar word, as it's experienced.
Right.
At the grassroots level. I mean, that's the story that needs to be told, and Kate is, she goes by Kate, and Kate is beginning to tell that, and I think that's the step that historians and sociologists and anthropologists of religions now need to take.
Yeah. Can you spell her last name one more time?
B-O-W-L-E-R, Catherine Bowler.
Oh, Bowler, like bowling. Okay.
Yeah,
bowling.
Yeah, just title of blessed.
Okay. Can I just respond to the Osteen
Quickly, Sally, anyway, I want to get some others, and we're going to take a break.
Yeah, But I specifically asked him last week about prosperity gospel, and it was the one time I've ever seen him get upset. And he said, "I'm not out there saying if you believe in Jesus Christ, you're going to get rich. That is so not what we're talking about here. We're talking about what you say that Bowler's talking about, which is that you'll be spiritually rich. There are others out there who preach what they call prosperity gospel, which is believe in Jesus Christ and you'll get rich. I mean, that is an actual thing that's going on, but I don't think that Osteen is not part of his message.
But I would just say that I was more sympathetic towards him when I only had read the books that he wrote in times of material prosperity in the mid-2000s. And then when I read his book that came out and was a direct response to the recession, I felt that it was this sort of prosperity side of the message was much balder and, I mean, to me, more offensive. That made me less favorably disposed than I had been 5 or 7 years ago.
He's becoming more repressed.
He's backed off. But at least in his initial reaction to the setbacks, he was more, you know. And again, it's why the message has appeal, right? It's like at the moment when people are most worried about their finances, it makes sense that, you know, that you would want to say something that directly addresses their finances. But the way that he addressed it in that, I think it was the book that came out in 2009 or something, that kicked off his last tour, was, I think, much balder in, you know, well, you're down now, but you just need to think in the supernatural and God will give you increase. Okay.
Grant, quickly on this. We got
no,
three.
No, go ahead. Yep.
You sure?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, we got Colin Murphy and Ray Hahn and then Rich Mao, and we're done. No pressure, just...
I thought somebody by now was going to ask you for all the off-the-record bits, but I'm not going to. But there was something else you said, Grant, that I wanted to ask about. When you were talking about the responses from Billy Graham to all the letters that he gets, I think what you said was, I see this as so American, when you were describing the kind of advice that was given. And, you know, there's a tendency of all religions to become embedded, I mean, because they are embedded, in the cultures that they inhabit, and to take on some of those characteristics. And I think it was Alan Wolfe who talked about the tendency of all American denominations to become, over time, kind of congregational. And when I look at American religion today, and also at the country that it's embedded in, it doesn't surprise me, for instance, that my own religion, Catholicism, and many evangelical denominations don't seem all that humble, because the country that they're in has a tendency towards a kind of can-do, optimistic, not very humble attitude. And someone like me kind of counts on religion for humility as one of the great things it brings to the table. And I wonder if there's a way out of this box, in a sense. Or perhaps it's not a problem, but I'd be interested in knowing what you think.
Oh, yeah, Dave. Send you a check. Thank you. I'm not going to, but it's what I ought to do, because it's an incredibly important point, and trying to understand Graham, the phenomenon of Graham in American life. At one point, Aaron, if I still could figure out a way to get into this title, that this is a religion of a second chance. And this is, I mean, is so deeply embedded in all these letters, is a kind of desperate cry for a second chance. And this is what comes back in the responses, is that there's another chance. And I said it's so American because, I mean, this is what William Jennings Bryan was about. There's a second chance in the political realm. And following up on the two most prominent evangelists, at least within the Protestant sphere before Graham, were Amy Semple McPherson and Billy Sunday. And again, you know, these are religions of religious messages of a second chance, but far more so with Graham. And so there's a possibility of rebuilding one's life. And so in one sense, we get this entrepreneurial thrust, you know, as you're suggesting, Colin, which is expansive and, you know, it's broad-shouldered and muscular and all these kind of, you know, gendered, all this gendered language we could use. But at the second time, at the same time, there is a humility that has to be built in, or that is built in, that we've run amok. Our lives have run against the shoals, or on the rocks, and things have to be rebuilt. And part of that rebuilding is the humility of asking and acknowledging who we are and what's happened in our lives in order to rebuild. Now, that's all one cluster of issues. But at a more personal level with Graham, what we find, I think it's just overwhelming when you look at his personal comments and the reports of journalists who go to visit him, is they come back with these reports of the humility. Nancy Gibbs and Michael Duffy, who I've never met, I'm sure some of you have from Time, introduced their book by saying, when you go to visit Graham, the sincerity is like paint stripper. And said, you just come away just with this sense of this person, of this extraordinary humility, which they use humility and sincerity interchangeably. Now, why I think that's important in a broader sense is that the press reports on it. And when the press reports on it, then whatever the personal characteristic is, it's amplified. And so it seems to me that that's a feeling that the broader population also understands and esteems and sees as important.
Yeah. Ray Hahn, you're up. And then Rich.
So I see.
I don't need this
to be the last. Oh, gosh. Well, that actually changes everything. My goodness. Rod Dreher a few years ago contrasted Alistair MacIntyre's Benedict option against what he called the Benedict temptation. The Benedict option being the idea that one should retreat from a kind of debased culture to form more robust Christian communities on the fringe of that debased culture. And the idea of the Benedict temptation is that, no, in fact, that idea is very dangerous. We should be in dialogue with the broader culture, et cetera. And I get the impression that your book, your work, is much more in that latter vein. The idea that, actually, there's at least some slender reed of hope for some kind of revival of a robust Christian culture, and that's what we should look towards, and that's what we should hope for, et cetera. But I wonder, given a lot of the pessimism you've encountered today, and some that actually kind of lives inside your own brain, I wonder if you've thought about kind of some institutions that have actually been living the Benedict option, some projects that you feel have really been kind of successful in your view, or rather been more successful than others. Have you seen kind of manifestations of a kind of Christian culture that really does reject the mainstream and is trying to build some kind of alternative that you find promising that makes you doubt the idea that actually it's more temptation than real option?
Well, we did spend our morning talking about the Mormons, as I recall. And one of the fascinating things about the Mormon Church is that for all of certainly my own vast theological differences with LDS doctrine and practice, the Mormons have been the only major, I will take a side in the, Christian or non-Christian debate and say the only major Christian body in the United States to maintain a robust, influential, successful sort of parallel culture that has seemed to resist some of the trends that I've described. And this shows up. For instance, we have these endless debates in my line of work where if you're writing about sort of sex and the culture wars and abortion and so on, liberals will say, well, look, blue states have lower rates of out-of-wedlock births, and then conservatives will say, oh, but they have higher abortion rates too, right? And you have these kind of debates, and you're like, well, is there anywhere in the United States that has low abortion rates and low out-of-wedlock birth rates? Well, there is one state, and it's the state of Utah. So just on like sort of narrow questions like that, is it possible? But the downside of that is the one that my colleague Professor Brooks brought up this morning, which is the extent to which, to many outsiders to Mormon culture, it does seem like Mormons are stuck in the 50s, right? That the reason they've been so resilient is that they've just sort of walled themselves off from these trends, and they still seem like the Cleavers or Donnie and Marie, and that Mormonism's resilience is actually just sort of, it's only resilient because it's still a relatively small body, and so it hasn't been large enough to go through the kind of convulsions that Catholicism went through in the 70s and 80s. And that's why I'm interested in some of the issues I raised about you know, archaeology and history and Mormonism's ability to sort of confront the secular academy over the next 100 years, because I think those will actually be crucial to its future. But my broader sense is that I don't know, you know, if there is a more a Catholic or Protestant version of the Mormon approach that is completely possible. Mormons obviously have a very distinctive history and a very distinctive geographical position and so on. And I don't know if, you know, I don't believe in sort of a model of withdrawal. And I think my fundamental reason for that is suggested by the subtitle of the book, which in a way is obviously very critical. I'm calling people heretics and so on. But when you call people heretics, you're basically saying, well, you know, you're Christians too, in some sense. Even if you don't acknowledge how Christian you are, you're still Christian too. And we're all, as Americans, still somehow operating under, you know, we can call it a Judeo-Christian paradigm if you want, but I don't think of America as a sort of genuinely post-Christian culture. I certainly don't think of it as a secular or pagan culture. And as long as that's the case, I think people who have my own beliefs just, you can't withdraw from a culture with which you still have so much in common. And so that is, I think, the case for, you know, whether you're a conservative Christian or a liberal Christian or some other religion, you know, it's the case for engagement is, you know, for all the trends that Bill was talking about towards atomization, and, you know, we have a lot in common as Americans, and we can still have these arguments, and they're worth having, and that's a reason for saying, let's have them, and let's not just move to, you know, North Dakota, homeschool our kids, and grow organic vegetables. But in 20 years, I'll be on a farm, and I'll see you there.
Hold it. Grant Wacker gets to have the final words here.
Well, there's no way I could top the North Dakota and organic. This is not elegant by any means, but it's a very quick comment. Half of my life is teaching in a divinity school, and so I stay in touch a lot with my divinity students who come back after 5 years, 10 years, and I am recurrently impressed by the strength of the rural church and the stories that they come back with about the rural church. And I think that part of our focus, is certainly mine, is just, you know, the stuff I've worked on has mostly been about, you know, urban situations, the cosmopolitan situation. The kinds of stories that big city dailies would write about. And the life of the rural church or the parish, and there'd be far fewer rural synagogues, but still, I mean, it often flies under the radar screen of those of us who are sort of professionally involved of looking at it. So I don't know what the larger implications are, but there certainly is great resilience in certain segments of the population, and if we could isolate, you know, where that resilience, the components of that resilience, and how to extend it into the rest of the population, we'd be better off. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, join me in thanking our
Thank you.
Presenters.
Thank you.